Create an atmosphere of worship. Exalt your God. Glory. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. immense iniquity he transgressed. For example, is when he saw a woman. He didn't look away. He went back and schemed. And now he could lay with that woman. He didn't stop at that. David says, have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion. Blot out my transgressions. Blot out my transgressions, he said. Wash away all my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is always before me. You know, for those who drive vehicles, who drive any moving motorized equipment on the road, you know you have a vehicle number of that, the front and the back. So you cannot hide away because everybody will know that number of that. It's before you, even behind you. So David is giving us that example. They are before you, before us. For every one of us here. Say, against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you have proved right when you speak and justified when you judge. So instead of saying, if God were to strike him for his sinfulness, his transgression, his iniquity, God would be justified. But then it goes on and says, surely I was sinful at birth. Sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Surely you desire truth in the inner part. You teach me wisdom in the inmost place. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I'll be clean. Wash me, and I'll be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity. A clear illustration of blotting out is when you get ink on a sheet of paper or a polythene and you just see that ink not drying. You get a blotting paper for those children who use fountain pens. That blotting paper nearly sucks that ink from that surface. And that's what David asking God to do regarding his sins, regarding his iniquity. Then he goes and says, create in me a pure heart, O God. Renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will come back to you. Save me from the black guilt of God. And God will say, see, David is praying for not only himself, but even the others. He'll even teach the others to see their transgression. Save me from black guilt of God, and God will say, and my tongue will sing of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. You do not delight in sacrifice, oh, I will bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. Oh God, you will not despise. in your good pleasure make Zion prosper. Build up the walls of Jerusalem. Then there will be righteous sacrifices. Hold burnt offerings to delight you. Then bulls will be offered on your altar. And I think that should be the cry of our hearts, that we quickly realize, of course, with the Spirit of God, our sinfulness, all spiritual transgression. Let's thank the Lord for that. Let's bless the name of the Lord. First time visitors in the house? Any of us visiting for the first time? We'd love to appreciate you. You could put up your hand if you're a first time visitor. Okay, since all of us are the age men, we're not first time visitors, so we need to continue working in bringing first time visitors so that we continue growing physically also in addition to growing spiritually. Any new members of GFM? New members? You might not be a first time visitor, but you're a new member. We also appreciate you, and you're welcome again. I know all of us have things to thank God for. So you're welcome, two or three people to testify God's goodness. Few minutes for you. Testimony time. I see hands. Yes. Welcome.
Praise the Lord. Yeah. I'm Senoga Martin. I want to thank God so much for saving my life. This week I was heading to Kasese, and I was going by link bus, but then one of the tires burst. Then the bus started swinging left, right, and center, and people started praying because it was really a moment. But I just want to thank God that somehow he gave wisdom to the driver, and he calmed down the bus, and then it was fixed. And then we later went on to our journey. So I want to thank God because anything could have come. So I thank God for life.
Praise Jesus. Allow me to give testimony when I'm leaving. Lord and God, all the glory and honor goes to you. I came back to town 2 months ago. I met 2 months working in Kampala yesterday. And when I came back, the Lord just did this offer for me. But then when I came, I was supervising someone who was on the program. And then I said, Lord, how do I establish myself? I can be an advisor, but I'm not established. Because the person I'm supervising has been on the program. But as we sang this song, the Lord has been so gracious to me. In these 2 months, the Lord has made me excellent at work. The Lord has established me. Lord, thank you for the power. Thank you for your righteousness. May we choose to trust you. I remember Pastor Gordon told me, Lord, you have to establish and work at your workplace. Right now, how do I do this? This is so difficult. So I said, Lord, give me wisdom. Tell you to go. And brethren, the Muslims are praying a floor below me. They have an altar there. And I was sharing to establish an altar. So may the Lord help us to really know the power that we have and establish altars at the marketplace.
Hallelujah, church.
Amen.
Hallelujah, church.
Amen.
When I in the next miracle, Sarugana, Revenia, Mida, never some come up, Roblam Wangi. Never some come up, Wanga, little doctor, and they look up, Jan Pukako. On Saturday, Nayo Mugolo, then I then met Roy. Catch your Mugolo, and we are next Friday.
Let's appreciate Brother Jimmy once again and the choir for leading us very well. Praise the Lord. You are very, very welcome. I thank God for the opportunity to minister to you this morning. I bring you greetings from Pastor Godson, who is away on some very important ministry duty, but he sends his love and greetings. Amen. Well, I also wish to welcome back our holiday makers. This time we have had holiday makers joining us in phases because of the exams, the timetable. So any holiday maker who joined us this week, Amen. Okay. It seems we don't have any this service, but you are also you are all very welcome. Brethren, thank you for coming for this service. And it's my prayer that God will speak to us, because the Bible says that it is Him who draws us to Himself. And if He has drawn us to Himself this morning, we will not, it will not be wasted time. Surely He has something to talk to us. Amen? So you are not here by accident. So God has a reason for having us gather together this morning. Amen?
Amen.
So I'll pray and then we'll proceed. Father in heaven, thank you so much for yet another opportunity to be in your house. Thank you that you've given us life. The Bible says the dead do not praise the Lord. Lord, we praise you because we are alive. We praise you because you've provided for us. You've guarded us. You've protected us from known and unknown challenges. Father, the fact that we are here, all the praise, glory, and honor belongs to you. Father, as we continue in your presence, minister to us, Father. Heal the sick. Strengthen the weak. Those who came with questions, Father, speak to us, so that by the time we leave this place, we'll have been touched by you. We thank you, Lord. We bless you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Yeah, last Sunday was a family Sunday, and we had a very wonderful sermon by Elder Samuel Bagonza. He led us very well, and among the key issues that he took us through was that you have two types of families, the godly families that depend on God for their sustenance, and the ungodly ones that depend on the evil one. Amen? But where we ended, we had agreed that we are safer being godly families. Isn't it? We agreed that it was safer being in the hands of the Almighty than in gambling, belonging to the ungodly families. We also had a good time. We interacted with our sons and daughters. We had a good fellowship. Do I have any witness in the house? Okay, I thought I was the only one who had enjoyed. But it's good we also enjoyed. We also feasted together. We had a whole day together. We had lunch. We had a cup of tea in the evening. And it was really family. He also showed us how the earthly family also relates to the family of God. So we belong to the bigger family of God together. Amen? The individual families somehow are mirrored with the family of God. We brought that out very well, and I know we are very blessed. Amen? So today, our focus is on Jesus as the focus for this season. We are in a month there, December, where a number of planned and unplanned festivities cover the month of December. And it is always a time when people are moving up and down, countless feasts. But as we go through them, whether we go through them or as we witness them, let our focus not be on those feasts. Let our focus be on Christ, the author and the finisher of our faith. Amen? And December normally is looked at as a month where everybody has some extra time. Because like now, terms are already closed. And we have our primary school children, the secondary school, even those in colleges. So most of the festivities are put around the month of December because we seem to all be around. Those who work abroad also flying, and we normally tend, it's some sort of reunion. Our workplaces organized end of year parties. A number of feasts from December. Even those who fail to organize their birthday parties end up organizing their party, some sort of party. Maybe what a son or daughter had their birthday, but it was during the school time. Then they said, no, don't mind, let's combine it with the Kathy's, then we celebrate together. I've seen that. So it is normally a time of festivity, dance, and then Christmas food. Those who built houses, even if it got completed in August, for some reason, they pushed the official entering of the house in December when the children are back, friends who work far off are nearby and they can join in. So it normally brings a lot of festivities. The section of people who love cruising on the water, they organize pleasure cruises and they go on water, they are drinking, whining, dining, dancing, and some of these normally lead to capsizing, sometimes because people are intoxicated, everybody forgets the role they have to play and it ends up in tears. But all that is part of the festivities. We also have parties, the type of sari white party. I don't know whether you have, those who read newspaper, you must have seen it somewhere. Because during COVID, it missed a bit, but now it is some sort of reunion that is going to be organized. And people are warming up for those kind of festivities. And as people are warming up to go and happen, even the thieves use the opportunity to start planning. They try to monitor what time does this family go out? How long do they stay there? What time do they normally come back? They are also planning. That is their plan. The thieves, even those who are setting up traps for others, they set up a trap and they ensure you fall into that trap. Even the young people who have been at school during this long vacation, they also have plans. And they are also planning to do their stuff. People who are into sports, the rugby and what, they organize even free drinks, chewing gum, which are normally intoxicated. They have cited some young girls that they want to abuse. They take advantage, they say booze is free. Also chewing gum, they start passing it around. You take it, then the eyes start, you look as if you are dozing, yeah? And then they know this one is already trapped. All these combined normally lead to a lot of mischief, unwanted pregnancies, use of drugs, and all other kind of things. Those who want to invest in killer joints, they also target this time when people seem to have saved some extra money for enjoying pleasure. There is also a category these days of corporate prostitution, where older girls are bribed by rich businessmen to get for them young, beautiful girls. On a commission, of course, and those normally lead to physical and sexual abuse. Even those who deal with, who deal in blood sacrifices, at this time, they are up and waiting and targeting a number of people. That's why around this time, there are also many road accidents, because those who deal in witchcraft also rise in power and are looking for those that will be sacrificed on our roads. Amen? So this is a time when we have to really be vigilant. We need to be very, very vigilant. Others plan sleepovers. It's like, Daddy, can I go and sleep at Kathy's place? I just a sleepover. The sleepover normally leads to some form of abuse. So, like we discussed last time, Sometimes you see parents restraining you, and you are like, but daddy is too much, mommy is too much. Doesn't he or she trust my judgment? These are some of the things that as parents we look at and restrain you. It's also a day, it's also a time when families, those that celebrate last funeral rites, this is the time. All the rituals that go with it also happen. But it's also a time when people experience heartbreaks. With these festivities that that go on, most of which are ungodly, families tend to shed tears. You find that a husband abandons the family, a wife abandons the family. So a lot of infidelity takes place. But while all these festivities are going on, brothers and sisters, we need to get prepared and to focus on Jesus Christ. It is Him who does not change. All other things change. But the Bible tells us in Hebrews 13, verse 8, that is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Other things will change, but for Him, He is the same. That's why in a time like this, we need to hold on to Him. It is Him who will be dependent. People have promised, made a lot of promises to us, but at a time when they are supposed to fulfill, they are not sure. True or false? It is Jesus who has promised that will never leave us nor forsake us. It is Him who will show up when we are in trouble. Amen? So at a time like this, where people are celebrating many things, there are so many enticements, it is Him that we are supposed to look to. So one thing that I recommend to you, brothers and sisters, that we need to look to Jesus, is the author and perfecter of our faith. So when we read Hebrews 12, verse 1 to 3, the Bible says, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a crowd of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely. There are so many weights that cling onto us. And those weights pull us away from God. It may be a weight of poverty. And because of poverty, you are thinking, but what did I do to God? Why is it that everybody has food, but I'm struggling with the family? It could be an issue where you see the rest of your brothers and sisters in your family seem to be doing well. You are the one who is always struggling. Then that alone pulls you away from God. But Hebrews 12:1 says, we have a great crowd of witnesses. That alone should inspire us to lay aside every weight and sin which is clinging so closely. Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Let us run with endurance. Your miracle that you are waiting from God may not happen soon, but Hebrews 12:1 is saying, let us run the salvation race with endurance. Without endurance, brothers and sisters, we can't make it. Why? Because you may be giving God only this week to give you what you are looking for. But God's timing many times is different from our timing. So we need endurance. Once we do not endure, once we don't wait on God, you say, God, if I don't hear from you this week, I've given up on you. For sure, you'll give up on God, but where you are going, things are not elevated. Amen? Verse 2 says, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of God. Amen? When Pastor was illustrating for us what Christ was putting on as he was being crucified, he actually said, they just put that cloth around him just to reduce the shame. But actually, the Bible says he was crucified naked. They removed all his clothes that he was putting on, and they divided them among themselves. He was crucified naked. But even when he was crucified naked, he despised that shame that he had to experience. Why? He was focusing on the greater, reward which was set before him. That's what the Bible says. Looking to Jesus, the founder and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. If he had not endured that shame, he would have lost the opportunity to stake the seat that is at the right hand of God. Amen? And the Bible tells us he's the only one who is seated there. Now, suppose he had not endured that shame, he would have lost that privilege. Amen? Right now, brothers and sisters, there are going to be very many enticements that come to us. They may be bribes. They may be promises of many things. If you accept ABC, I'll marry you. If you accept this and this, I'll do this for you. Too many enticements. But according to Hebrews 12, 1 to 3, let us despise all those and focus on Christ, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. Amen? Because when we take our eyes from him, we may end up hurting ourselves. When we remove our eyes from Christ, whatever enticements are out there pulling us, they have hooks on them. It is like when people are trapping fish, they put something. So the fish comes thinking it will be wise to eat the worm and go without any scratch. As they are trying to get the worm, they end up being trapped. Amen? So, the Bible also gives an example of a husband and a wife who fell into this trap, and that was Adam and Eve in Genesis chapter 3. The Bible says God had actually instructed Adam and Eve on how they should live. And as they are going around enjoying life, great food, no sweat, everything was provided for in the Garden of Eden. But now the devil, the serpent, was very wise. The Bible says it was wiser than all the animals that were in the garden. So it came and talked to Eve, enticed him, says, why you are eating everything, but I've not seen you eating this beautiful, fresh, juicy tree. And then it was like, God told us not to. God told us not to. I said, you can eat all the others. But this one, So he had to, he said, no, God knows if you eat, you are going to be wiser. You are going to be like him. Yeah, please. And when he removed the eyes from God and put them on the serpent, she got distorted. The beauty, the joys, the everything pulled her. She ate the fruit, took even to the husband. The Bible says, by the time when God came to have communion, It was like, yeah, you know, when you find them around here, where are they? Tell him. Said, we are hiding from the world. We are naked. Did you eat the fruit, the tree that I told you not to eat? What followed were stories. You see,